Welcome to Trapping Across America, where fur brothers meet every week. But we're still allowed to be men, and we're proud to be from the land of the fur and the home of the brave. This is your host, Clint Locklear, for Trapping Across America. This week, we're going to be talking with Carrol Black from Blackie's Blend from Ohio. I did not really think I was going to get him to be able to do the interview just because he's pretty old school when it comes to stuff like this. And he thinks that the newer guys have more stuff to say, and I highly disagree with that. Me and Scott Welch kind of worked on him, kind of shamed him a little bit, kind of tried to get him in a corner. Well, finally, I got him to do the interview, and you are going to truly enjoy this. If you don't know who Blackie is, back in the fur boom, he used to do a lot of instruction, a lot of stuff with Ray Milligan and things. They'd drive around in Helfridge, and they do these classes, but he was known for his river trapping. And let me tell you, when you hear this interview, and you hear this, the depth and the length of perfection that Blackie went at when he went on his river line, it is inspiring in one way. If you didn't know any better and you didn't know that Blackie was going trapping, you would think they were putting his canoe and him trapping behind enemy lines somewhere in Afghanistan. He looked at every single detail. His motivational way of looking at it, when he gets to talking, is I don't know how else to say it, but it's just inspirational, because he refused to be tired and he refused to get cold, and no matter what, he was going to catch those coon. And that mentality is not always there with the world we live at today, but to me, it was just such a good thing to hear that coming. And I greatly appreciate Blackie taking the time to do the interview with us. And I know you're going to thoroughly enjoy it, because I know I did. We've got a new sponsor this week. It's Fur Harvesters Trading Post. We're F&T is how a lot of people know them. And they're out of Alpena. And they have everything you need for your trapping, hunting with hounds, and predator calling. If you've never looked at their website before, you'll also find, besides your trapping and snaring supplies, they also have footwear and clothing, tan fur and home decor, general outdoor supplies. They're running some specials this week. It's something a lot of trappers are going to need. They're running a special on red powder trap dye. They've also got a special on Duke No. 2 coil springs and H-type conibear or body grip style traps. So check out their website, which is fntpost.com, www.fntpost.com. Or you can call them at 989-727-8727. Our other sponsor this week is Oki Cable and Trap Supply. Now, Jeb's also running a special right now, and it's on the Z traps. A lot of the dog-proof traps are getting hard to find because supply is not really meeting the demand this year, and I think he can get his hands on the Z traps still, and he's running a special on those. So if you're looking for a push-pull style dog-proof trap, give Oki Cable and Traps Supply. You can call him at 918-429-4648, or you can reach him at www.oktrapsupply.com. And Jeb, you know, like he always says, he's big enough so he can get you a deal, and he's small enough to make sure you get the customer service you deserve. The Predator Control Group product of the week is our Texas Predator School. I haven't talked about this in a while. We only have a few slots left. If you're thinking about going down to Texas with us, you might want to kind of get on the ball a little bit. If you don't know what it is, we hold a school, and we're only going to have two students at a time this year with two instructors, and we're going to go out in Texas on a real predator control job, and we're going to have you trapping and snaring coyotes and bobcats and badgers and raccoons and turning loose javelinas and catching hogs, chance of catching a mountain lion, eating some really good Mexican food, staying at some nice places down there on these ranches. all behind locked gates. All you need to do is show up with your equipment. We've got the vehicles for you. Once you get there, there's no other cost involved, but there's only a few slots left. And mostly that's because we actually have some students that are coming back from next year. They enjoyed it so much. So if you're interested in our Texas Predator School, you can email me at clint@wolfernation.com, or you can call me at 423-949-5273, and I'll explain what it is and how much it costs and deposits and all that and where it is in Texas, so you'll have a complete understanding of what it is. Not only will you learn a lot, you'll catch a lot, plus you're going to have a great time. Well, let's go and get started. Let's get in the right frame of mind here. Let's think about a nice, cool, flowing river in Ohio when the leaves are changing, the coon is prime, and here comes Blackie down the bend. Okay, I'm with Carrol Black. We're actually sitting out in the parking lot at 7 o'clock in the morning in a van, and I finally got him to interview. I don't know if you know this, Blackie. The concept of this whole thing I've done, all these shows, the websites and everything, was sparked when me and you were talking on the phone one time and you were talking about the canoe and the ice and all that type of stuff. And I was like, that would be so amazing if other people could hear some of the conversations that I get to have with people. And that's actually why. And I was trying to figure out, because you're so old school and hard-headed about the way you do a lot of things, I was like, I don't know if I'm going to get him to even do the interview or a interview, because you just go, I don't need to do that. But I finally got you here, and I appreciate you coming. Now, if anybody that knows, name's Carrol Black. It's Blackie's Blends Lures, and you're about 22, aren't you, Blackie?
Yeah. Yeah, put 50 onto that.
So, have you been trapping your whole life? How did you actually
start? When I was 11 years old. I was over to my uncle's, and we was visiting. Back in the day, people did that. They visited. And my parents was over there. It was Dad's brother. And he had some fur fishing game magazines laying around. And of course, I was bored. The old people talking, you know. And so I started looking at them magazines. And my Uncle Clyde said, well, you know, I'm done with them. You can take them home if you want and read them. And of course, Bill Nelson was at his prime man, and I never have found anybody that could put it on paper better than Bill.
He was an artist with words.
Well, yeah, people say, hey, he's 20 years ahead of his time, and I say he's right up there now with anybody. And that was what, 50 years ago? Mm-hmm. I mean, or more. And the man's ads were just, I've seen it today, they're still copying stuff out of his ads. And I used his lures. I wouldn't say that they worked the best of any lure I ever had in my area, but they were more of a Western lure, but they were put together better. They just, I think Sherm Blom said it all in his book about Bill Nelson. They were powerfully fragrant, and I've never smelled anything that smelled quite like them. When I was a kid, the two best lures I'd ever used was Herb Lennon's and Hallbaker's. You know, mm-hmm. Worked good in that farmland, you know. But Nelson had some unique smells on his muskrat lure. Even though it was thin, was just unbelievable. I remember I dropped a little bit of that by accident in the water, dripped off a stick, and that oil slick just spread from bank to bank. Right now.
One thing about his ads, because, you know, there's the book that's come out, and you got to see a lot of them, and I got a lot of the old magazines that I kind of cruised through. One thing about it, if you were gonna buy his lures, you had confidence when you were buying those things, that's what you wanted.
Oh yeah, yeah. I've referred to him in articles and even in a ad I just wrote as the master painter of dreams. And he just, well, he was ahead of his time. He had a way of putting it on paper. I've never seen it since.
So you've been into lure making how long, Blackie?
I started, it was really 81. Commercial, so I've been in at 30, just a hair over 30. And by the way, one thing I wanted to say about Nelson that I forgot there is I've got some personal letters from Bill. I said, someday they'll auction them off, not because my name's on them, but because of Bill Nelson, you know, mm-hmm. personal correspondence with Bill. And he had a very distinctive handwriting. Even though he typed these letters, he hand-addressed them, you know, on the outside, the envelope, and signed them. Real big print. And I could tell his handwriting anywhere.
Well, I think in our technology, and I know you don't do very much of it, but you know what's out there. And but we, you know, it's so easy now to shoot an email, get an email, do a text, Skype, whatever you're going to do, and it's instant. But those letters, because I've got some from Craig, it was a lot more personal. It meant a lot more when you that than it does an email.
That's a lost art. Nobody writes letters anymore, you know. I answer a lot of people, but it's email now because my wife knows how to run the computer. I don't. Had my way, it'd be in the ditch out in front of the house. But you got to have a computer or UPS won't cooperate with you. So I got one, but I don't have a cell phone. I guess you could say, well, that ain't old school, Blackie. That's just ignorance. But hey, you know, I just don't have a use for a cell phone. I think they're handy. And I have nothing against them. It's the overuse and abuse of them that bother me. Mm-hmm. And people driving down the road, you got that thing stuck in a bracket up on the dash talking, that's fine. It's just like somebody's riding with you. But when you got one in your hand and, yeah, right, something like that.
I'm showing my Bluetooth.
right, something like that, that's fine. I got nothing against them. It's just overkill. I go in a restaurant, I've seen people order for their kids. Because the kids on the cell phone won't look at the menu. You know what I mean? That's extreme, but yeah, I'm old school.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. When if someone, like I said, there's a lot of people, I was telling you before we interviewed, because of the way the internet is, with the way we've got all this interlinked with YouTube, there's a lot of guys that may or may not know who you are. Because they don't come to conventions, they've never bought a trapping book, they just search it out. So your kind of claim to fame was trapping back in the fur boom when you wrote your books, and you know, when your lure started.
Right.
So kind of what did you do back then?
You mean for notoriety?
Well, you can say that, but I mean your trapping style. What did you?
You mean what animals have I trapped? Well, I've trapped California, I've trapped Wyoming, Arizona, New York, Indiana. I've even trapped Pennsylvania. And back then, it just seemed like the word spread. People knew, and then I run a lot more conventions than I do now. I tried to hit 10 major conventions a year, major by like... Minnesota, you know, a state meet, you know, New York State, Minnesota, you know, hit the big ones, and I've tapered way back now. It's not fun to just jump in my truck and drive 600-700 miles one way anymore. Used to be, you know, but that got old real quick, you know. I've stood behind enough tables, I've sweated enough, and I'm not a kid anymore. You know, give me a break.
you know, you did a lot of water trapping. We're going to get in the canoe because you're fascinated about that. But, you know, back in the day, and I've actually heard this story 4 or 5 times at this convention. You know, back in so-and-so, I went to a motel and met Blackie and Ray Milligan.
Yeah.
When I used to do the tour thing.
Yeah, Ray called me and asked me if I'd... go with him on that tour and do the water end of it, and he was looking basically for somebody who wasn't in the lure business, and I told him I'd just went in. He wasn't aware of that, and he said, that's okay, come along anyway. And the reason I was using a canoe and trapping coon is the fox population had went down years ago. It's down in the country now, but it went down years ago there, and I didn't have too much, and the river was there, and nobody messed around with the river when it was cold. And I'd trap out on land until it got cold, and the ground started freezing, and I started fighting it, and there wasn't much fur at that time left. So I jumped in the canoe and down the river I'd go, and by then the coon were coming down off the ridges. You know, I've always said that that's perfect when you got a river running through bottom land and you got them ridges on one side or maybe both sides for a while, and them coon will stay up on them ridges, and all you'll get if you start early is them little ones. Mm-hmm. But you get down there later, they'll come down when it starts freezing, and freezing hard, they come down to the mother, I call it, because that river is a barrier.
The mother.
Yeah, explain it's the giver of all food. It's the source. That's where they come to get their food. All the acorns and all the stuff up on the ridges are bare now. Everything's been feeding up there, and the turkeys and everything, and down they come. And there's that river land there. It ain't froze yet because it's big water, and you got that steam coming off of it, and there's food there, and it's a barrier. You know, they'll swim that river. I've caught coon right out in the river at daylight, swaddled them with a paddle, you know, because they're crossing. It isn't full light yet. And that's what I realized what they's doing. They come down off them ridges. That's where the den trees and everything are. They'll cross them rivers and get in them bottom fields and work them old cornfields and stuff, and then come back across. And if they're hunting, which is big time in Ohio, you know, well, that river's a barrier because that's safety for him. He'll get out in that river and drown the coon dog. And that river is wide enough, I trap. I don't care how good an arm you got on you. There's a lot of places you couldn't throw a rock across it. You know, it's got a little size to it. And that coon, he gets in that water, he's safe. Across he goes and up that bank, and he's gone.
Well, as many years as I've known you, when you said mother, I have to say that's the closest I've ever seen you stepping towards a hippie term that I've ever heard.
Well, I was just referring to it's the giver of life for this particular animal.
I know what you're saying now, but it just took me by surprise.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I didn't mean it in a dirty sense, you know.
Hippies don't have to necessarily, well, I guess they were, but that's not what I meant. It's so when you started floating that, you would start out on land, and then you'd wait till it get cold, and I think that was a good point you brought up. Because I know when everybody starts coon trapping, you're out in the summer, you see the tracks, you got opening day, a lot of younger trappers and new trappers run to that water, and they catch these little peeps, and then they get mad because they can't sell them for nothing.
What you get when you start early on coon is you get your small coon and your blue coon, and they're worthless. And I was out there, it was perfect for me trapping the land because we didn't have a lot of land predators. And by the time I got a couple weeks of that under my belt, I was trapping four counties. And I had 65 farms on them four counties I had permission on. I'd get them fox then down to where you're just chasing a few. We didn't have the coyotes in there then. Okay, and that's it. I'd bring them traps in out of the dirt and into the water they'd go, you know, and down the river. And by then, your coon was getting paler. In other words, she's getting a white coon. You're getting a prime coon, you know.
When did the season start back then? Was it earlier than now?
Yeah, in fact is, back in the day, there wasn't a fox season. You could start anytime you wanted, and guys were jumping the gun and catching some fox that didn't have enough hair on them to make a toothbrush, you know. And at least I had enough smarts not to do that, and I had permission. It was private ground, so I didn't have too much trouble that way, you know. And believe it or not, back in the day when I was first started land trapping, there wasn't a lot of people around that knew how to make a dirt hole, and if they did, they couldn't make it right. And then when the big fox, in the 70s, when the fox went so high, it got to where good luck on a dirt hole. I don't care who you are and how you make it, they didn't. It was almost like they've got a language. It's just like, I'll tell you what, you know how you've come up to your set that you had set there in the winter, in the springtime, and something's dug it out or something's worked it? I still say, and this is theory, But there's a lot of theory in this business. That old mother coyote, she comes out there with that string of pups. She comes up, she knows you. You come into that area all the time trapping. Mm-hmm. I'm talking agriculture, farmland, where guys trapping the same farms every year. She knows your smell. She comes up there to that dirt hole that she don't like and never did like, and she raises the hackles, and she, whether she could growls or whatever, she can communicate to them pups, and them pups are educated right there, at least in that sense. I won't take it any farther than that, but I think it goes that far. Mm-hmm.
There's some USDA studies that actually back that up. Some of the USDA studies back up what your theory is, and some of them go as far as think if the coyotes repeatedly see something, they can imprint almost genetically or however that's happening with the next generation of coyotes.
I believe it.
May or may not want to do something based on
that's right.
other experience.
But a flat set, I went to a flat set in 74 on my line to the point of exclusivity almost. And I mean, I'd use a dirt hole for a nose set, but the flat set was the fur getter and set 15, 20 feet off, you know, downwind. And it just paid off immensely for me. You know, that's when people were talking about it, but they wouldn't do it.
There's a lot more of that goes on today. Talk about flat sets, but they really don't do it.
Yeah, right. Right. And put a urine set down there. Or better yet, put a clump of grass and don't put any urine on it and let him mark it.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I used to pick a dropping up when we had droppings, when we had a population on the line, and take it with me and put on that clump. I wouldn't put any urine on it, because I always told people, you're lying to that predator and you're out there, and most of them know it. But I said, when they see that little dropping on that clump, that ain't a lie. He knows where that dropping come from.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll approach that different. That's the reason I was always, this is off the subject, and it's no commercial. But I always was a big believer, where there's heavy pressure, in giving them a two-way bait is the way they'll approach the set. If you've got mouse in that hole or something that he's familiar with in a mouse hole, he approaches that, and it's the theory again, a lot different than he would something that's got every perfume smell that France can put out that somebody's blended in a lure, and he circled that set and he found your little mouse hole set with the mouse in it. He knows he can whip that guy.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's done it yesterday. And I'm talking agriculture, you know, this is farmland trapping, and you'll get a quicker response.
Well, before we get to the canoes and vehicles, excuse me, you do something that some other guys may or may not do, but you advertise you do this, and we were talking about this yesterday. You've got some of the most natural looking fox urine that I've seen in a long time, and you were talking about freezing the urine. Now, do you mind covering that?
Well, I got tired of, when I started buying urine, I bought from a very knowledgeable person. He's no longer in the business, and he had absolutely the best urine that I've ever smelled in this business. He did. And Hallbaker wanted it, and Carmen, and some of the big names. So old Blackie kind of got squeezed out, even though I was one of the first to use it, and he'd promised me I'd always get at least a drum of it. And I remember talking to him, and I said, you know, your urine keeps better than about anybody else's, but it's still fox urine in the end. If you keep it through that heat where it yo-yos in the summer, it'll break it down. It's up to 90 one day, down to 78 the next day, back up to 90, and it breaks it down. And not that that ruins it, but I like hot news in the field. In other words, fresh news.
Mm-hmm.
I think he'll approach it quicker, better, and everything. And he said, you know, he said, if you want to keep this urine, and he said you could sell all the urine you ever wanted, he said, freeze it. And I said, well, that keep it. See, this is years and years and years ago. And that was a new concept and to me. I said, I'll give it a shot. So I started freezing this urine as soon as I'd get it. And I don't like it if it's over. I've kept it from one season to the next. If it's really fresh and you put it in a freezer, and you got to remove 20% of it to allow for expansion. And don't put it in with food. My God. But yeah, it goes right through that plastic. But, well, you guys don't know. You know, I don't want any divorces out of this. But I'll tell you, it keeps and it keeps good. And I've kept one season to the next, and it's not as good as what you get in fresh. But I'll tell you what, it's 75% as good, and you kept it from one year to the next. And I just a sticker. I like fresh urine, you know.
Well, to me, it makes sense because when you freeze it, you stop the bacteria from growing.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I think that has a lot to do with some of the funkiness that comes on over time.
Well, it does. It's more than just the heat. And sunlight, too. Sunlight's a great destroyer. You know, they always said, oh, this guy puts his lures in brown bottles. He don't want you to see what goes into it. And several people have over the years. But if you look, the finest wines and whiskeys and everything is put to protect from the ultraviolet rays, you know.
You hurt my ego there, because I think Jim Beam is the greatest whiskey, and it's in clear.
Well, I wasn't referring to favorites. I was just saying some of the finest.
I know. I'm just giving you a hard time.
I think Royal Crown's in a clear, isn't it?
I think it is.
And that's one of the more expensive.
But they put it in a velvet bag to block it.
Oh, yes. A velvet bag. Yeah.
So, kind of what I wanted you to talk about, because, you know, I think I read an article one time you wrote somewhere. Like I said, I've got magazines going back forever. And in your book, you talked a lot about the trapping and the, you know, the coonology and, you know, Blackie's Kingdom and all that, but the way you set that canoe up, it was like you were setting up something that was redundancy and ready to go to battle, to the point where you didn't have to worry about anything.
Everything on that canoe was overkill, strictly. There's nothing like a surprise when you're a 14 mile from the pickup point and your motor won't run, or something broke, or you're crippled. You got to have overkill. There cannot be too much overkill on the river. It's just like these guys, and we might get into this in the vehicles, they take a stock vehicle out in the desert and they wonder why, oh my God, I broke down. Duh. You know, I mean, you're talking, when I was in California trapping cats, all day long you was driving over rocks as big as footballs. All day long, and the only time you hit any pavements, go from pull-in to pull-in, you mm-hmm. know. And I'm driving back into the mountains. But to get back to the canoe, yeah, everything I soon found after running the river a couple years, that milk crates didn't fit. Buckets didn't fit. I set that thing up to where everything was out of the way and everything was built to function. And the motor mount was something to behold. My dad designed that. I went down there, took that canoe down, and I said, Dad, you won't believe the power this motor's got. And I had one of them little clamp-on things you screw and put on the side of the canoe. Why, shit, you might as well whistle up a hound's ass. I mean, that thing wouldn't hold the torque. Mm-hmm. I had a 70-pound thrust, and let me tell you something. That thing will push that canoe.
Absolutely, it will.
And the reason I wanted a motor, too, not only was speed, so I didn't have to paddle, I could spend my energy trapping, it was the noise level. Ain't no dogs barking. You run down through there with a gas motor, and that river was basically shallow in spots. And I had a rock guard. You got to have a rock guard built on the motor. And I had brass welds on it so it wouldn't vibrate loose. I had a friend build that. He's a technician plus. And the main thing when you mount that motor, and I had the wires running clear to the front of the canoe. I had went to an electrician and said, what gauge wire do I need to get him up there? And I think he said 9-all. I'm not sure now. Don't hold my feet to the fire, but you can check it out with the electrician and find out if you're interested in doing it. And I had a fiberglass block mounted on the side of the canoe where the motor wire is hooked onto with wing nuts. And I'd put my batteries clear in the front in that little compartment that won't hold anything in that 17-foot canoe. And that leveled the canoe out, because they weighed 55 pound apiece. That leveled the canoe out mm-hmm. when I'm sitting back there with my big hind end in the back, and there ain't no coon to put in it yet. See? And that kept the front end down empty when I started out. And a big tip on them motors is don't run them wide open. Unless you get in trouble, unless you get in a place that you have to have mm-hmm. wide open to get through, run it at 3/4 and you'll get a lot more miles out of it. And if you got any kind of current at all, that's plenty fast enough.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I've gotten the habit of using that to get way, way back into places in my John boat. And with a backup battery, I can almost go 8 or 9 hours pushing a 16-foot wide John boat.
If you get out in the sun, that sun hits them batteries, you'd be surprised what that does for them if it gets up around 50 that day. Another thing about your motor being down, they've got a T-bolt that holds it rigid, holds it down. This must be removed. It has to. You got to take that pin out. Because if you hit a rock going down through there with a 10-mile-an-hour current and you're going 10 mile an hour, you're going to do some damage to something
mm-hmm.
and you might even upset the canoe. You've got to have it so it'll trip back. If you hit something, it'll kick back. Plus I knew the channel in the river, you know what I'm saying.
Now, were you using aluminum or fiberglass?
Aluminum. Now, the kick on aluminum is they're noisy, but I had padded mine up, and I knew how to get in and out of that canoe and make absolutely no noise. I read everything I could read in the military books about the Special Forces team and how they insert and how they get out. And I applied some military technology to this, and I practiced in that canoe till I could remove the tools and put them back in, and there was no noise. I took and bought a cheap car mat, and they're easy to find for the back of a pickup truck now.
Mm-hmm.
They don't build them like they used to. They're real thin, and you know they're cheap when you go to push a box in and they double up on you. Mine won't do that because I got a heavy one, but for what I'm going to tell you, for you don't want a heavy one, you want a cheap one. And I cut that thing with shears to fit in those compartments so I could lay my tools in there and you don't have that ungodly noise going up and down the river because of that aluminum canoe.
That's a good tip. So what were you, how were you storing? Oh, I mean, if, because you were having some pretty big coon days.
That thing,
the weight.
I had a 17 foot and it would haul, including passengers, 750 as a mission craft. And I don't mind telling you that I had to split my line up in two sections after the DP trap come out because it increased the catch that much. And on the lower section and the upper section was both yielding about the same. If it wasn't flooded and it was a good night, I could be done by 1 o'clock in the afternoon, which is back in the day, you go till dark, you know what
mm-hmm.
I mean. But I was running the whole thing about 30 mile. This way I split it up in two parts, and I was running it every other day. I had slide wires, I had drowners, there wasn't nothing suffering, okay? And I was taking 30 coon, sometimes 32, 33, and that canoe was sitting low. And
That's what I'm picturing, yes.
Yeah, and it was very slow to respond. In other words, a 2-acre field that turned around. That's a gross exaggeration, but you know what I mean.
It was like a barge.
Right. And people say, well, what about a 12 or 15 footer, Blackie? They're more nimble. And yes, they are. And if you got a 5-mile run and that's all you're ever going to do. But I called it my freight liner, and that's exactly what it was. And one, it had a deep water keel. So it had a lot of stability. And I used to, where I was back in and nobody could see me, I used to stand a lot because the handle was up on the motor. I had a qualified Minnesota dealer cut the motor shaft down. I called Minnesota and asked him if that was possible and still keep the warranty, and they said absolutely. And he cut the shaft down to where I could, I didn't have to reach way up, you know, and I could turn that thing. And I had also called Minnesota and said, you know, I had a guy tell me I couldn't run them wires to the front. He said, they told me, the foreman of the shop up there that answered the phone told me, he said, you know something? He said, if you've got the proper gauge wire, you could run them wires to Cleveland. And I never forgot that because I never had a bit of trouble. Never. Never. Not an ounce of trouble. And I highly recommend Minnesota as the brand to run. I tried Shakespeare and Johnson and burn them up as fast as I could put them on there.
Mm-hmm.
They'd get hot. I had gauntlets on. Trust me, when it's 20-some degrees on that river, you wear gauntlets and you wear liners inside of them, and your fingers still get cold, and I got a frostbit finger to prove it on this hand for the motor, the first one here. And you could feel the heat through a Shakespeare on that thing. My Minnesota run cool. They must have heavier wiring or something, but it worked, that's all I know.
So how did, were you skinning on the line or?
No.
No.
Absolutely not. That's when I got into the fact I didn't have a skinner. Not everybody seems to be lucky enough to find one of them. And I got into the fact that you're trapping coon all day, and I just take it over to the buyer. He had a tumbler. He told me, he said, you don't need to worry. He said, I'm going to pay you put up price because he said your coon aren't shot up. He had a market for the carcasses. They were nice and fresh, and I had a deal worked out, and I just take them over, throw them on the floor, and he kept a running tally. And that was the way that was handled. You know, you're far too tired when you come in. And you, when you're out there and it's 22 degrees and the snow's blowing horizontal, you know, and you're in there, you don't want to stop and skin a cold, wet coon that's been on a slide wire. Trust me.
How were you then on your equipment, to get that equipment out to run 30 miles? That's a lot of equipment.
How well, at that time, it? I was running four batteries. I was hauling in that 17-foot canoe. I had two would take me down just a little farther than halfway, and I'd switch batteries. Now, listen, when you've trapped all day in that river and you come to that steep bank to climb out and pull your canoe out, you'd have had a real kick if you had a video of Blackie and chest waders slipping and sliding with a 55-pound battery in each hand trying to get up out of that river. And by the time you got wrestled two of them to the top and you thought you just got done wrestling a grizzly bear, you got to go down and get two more. And did I tell you there's some coon down there to bring up? Yeah. And of course you got the paddles, and I'd throw them up, but dragging that canoe up was fun too, you know. But I was a big, strong boy, and I was in shape. I hungered for that. I used to laugh at fatigue. I would spit on fatigue, pooey on fatigue. I would psych myself to where the adrenaline was flowing, and I wouldn't give up. You know, I'd say, I can't quit. They can't make me quit. I don't care how cold it gets. And the biggest thing on the river we haven't talked about yet is you got to keep dry and you got to keep the wind off of you. And I learned a trick. It took me 2 or 3 years before I learned this trick. When you get out that river, and she dropped me in before daylight, I never allow anybody to see me go in on that river. We got a lot of population. And I had a couple or three real special places I could get in, shut the lights off. I'd unload real quick, and then she'd pull away. She'd get that truck out of there, okay? I would never put my coat on. And my chest waders aren't on either. I'm not going to sweat, because if you break a sweat loading that canoe and it's below 30 degrees, when it gets about 8 o'clock in the morning on the river is the coldest time. Oh, it'll drop 10 degrees. I swear, 10 degrees. It is a bear. And you don't want to get wet. inside. Because then you get chilled and you shiver. And you're cold till it warms up that day, or maybe you never do get warm. Okay? And you're working out of a canoe. This is why you can't buy imported waders. You got to have good chest waders. And at that time, Lacrosse had the waders. I had to go to Cabela's to get a decent wader after Lacrosse went overseas. Because you're actually working all day out of that canoe. They say, well, if you ain't got nothing, you float on. Wrong. We've got so many trees hanging out over that river and them big ridges and them trees and little tributaries bringing them leaves in. Those slide wires are bowed with leaves. So you can tell when a guy's done it or he's bullshitting, can't you? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what you do is you pull that canoe up, and my anchor was one of those cheap, what they call a coyote grapple, but really in reality you'd use it on a fox. You know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And I had a rope on it. And I had it laying on top of the back of the canoe behind me, hooked in. I had a way of hooking it up, okay? And I had a piece of rubber laying up there so you could lay it up there and it wouldn't be any noise either. And I'd pull up to the bank and I'd hook it in, okay? And climb, slide out of that canoe real easy. So you're coming out almost at every set. Mm-hmm. You're coming out until you get rid of them leaves, till everything, which takes... I don't want to put a day figure on it, but it just seems like the first part of the fall, you're fighting that continually, you know.
Absolutely.
Even though I come down there after it got cold. You got leaf problems in that river. And I always use rocks. I'd set them up ahead of time, and I'd use rocks from year to year, the same rocks. I'd fish them out and hide them on the banks. You say, why don't you have a stake out there? You can't drive a stake in that gravel we had, and you want a movable anchor anyway because of the water fluctuation level, because of your water depth. You got to have a movable anchor, and
assuming you're saying this from experience.
What's that?
That you don't want to have a solid stake on the other end.
You
this
what?
This is coming from experience, I can tell.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And you pull enough of them stakes up and try to roll up the slide wire and redrive them, and the water splicing up in your face and all kind of stuff, and you learn real quick. And another thing about a rock is after you've slid that coon up, break the trap up and throw him on the bank, set that trap, okay, lay it on the bank, take and back out that slide wire with that rock between your heels and angle it slightly downstream, ever so slightly. Don't angle it a lot, because if your coon ever does get hind foot caught, he'll get up and get a hold of the bank, and he'll get a hold of roots, and he'll pull your slide wire in. Those coon can take a 20-pound rock and take it anywhere they want. You go, I almost go beaver size on them rocks. People say, my God, Blackie, how big a rock are you using? Some of them students, I give instructions, and I said, it don't move. I don't care how high the water gets. I don't care how big the coon is. I don't care what happens. If you have a tornado, that rock don't move. And I use that same rock. It's notched from year to year. There's portions on the line where there aren't any rocks, but there's portions where they are. When I get down there preseason, I load that canoe with rocks. It's sitting down in the water. I have put them where I need them, so I don't have the work now.
Mm-hmm.
See, this is the same line I'm going to run year after year. And people say, oh, slide wires are slow. No, they're not. Once you got them set up, they're the fastest thing you can have. Okay, because I don't want the bank tore up. I don't want anybody seeing that coon. I've had actual catches where I've floated up and I'd say, it's okay, it's okay. And I see the traps going because I got these holes dug up out of the water because of fluctuation. In Ohio, we have no natural lakes. So that means we got locks, we got dams, and there's a mean little man up on that dam. It hadn't rained in 10 days and he decides he's gonna raise that river level 18 inches. Blackie's got his holes up and I got my traps dug in just like a fox set. Now, a lot of times I'll pick up a big armload of leaves, but they're old leaves, ancient leaves, the ones that are on the bottom that are all flattened out, okay, and I'll take and put them in the canoe, and when that trap's dug in, I'll fit them leaves around at the mouth of that hole. I never set up in the hole. never, never, never do I set up in the hole. A mink likes to poke his head in the hole. That don't mean he's going in. And I like that trap centered in front of the hole because your coon approaches from the side, just like a dirt hole predator does. If it's centered, it's offset. Besides, when people offset stuff, I say, oh, you know if he's right-handed or left-handed. Mm-hmm. How did you know that? I want you to tell me that because I've always wondered that. I know, I'm being sarcastic, but it always, always... I told Johnny Thorpe once, I says, I set tight and I center, and he said, so do I.
That's what he showed me when I went up there.
Yeah, right. I always did. I like to fly in the face of adversity.
So you were telling me a story, I guess this was 2 years ago, the last time you went down the river. I laughed so hard, listened to your misery, because you were saying how you know, the ice flows. You had open water where you put in.
Yeah.
And it didn't last that way very long.
No, I got down the river several miles, and all of a sudden I saw something white. And I stood up in the canoe so I could get a better look, you know. And I says, holy mackerel. And that thing was froze clear across for as far as you could see. And I'm in the middle of nowhere. I mean the middle of nowhere. Out come the canoe, out come everything, and down the road I went till I found a house with a phone. Now there a cell phone would work.
Yeah.
If I could get a signal. See, I've noticed that. I used to ride an ATV for enjoyment, and we'd go into these almost wilderness places, and you'd see some guy playing with his cell phone, he can't get a signal. So,
not doing him any good.
They're so unreliable.
Well, when we go to places in Texas, a lot of times I've literally got to drive 50 minutes just to get a bad signal to make a phone call, check messages and stuff like that, then drive all the way back.
That's an inconvenience. Yeah, there ain't a payphone out there on a cactus, is there?
No. So how are you storing your stuff in there? You said you didn't use milk crates.
Well,
you just weren't throwing them in there.
I carried one milk crate that was painted. Everything's camouflaged inside and out on that canoe. Everything. It's so important to... Well, I've got several bridges that I go under. I'll answer your question, but I got several bridges, and people have a habit there in Ohio. I don't know what it is about them Buckeyes. They're just fascinated. Even though they drive across that river every day, they pull up on the center of that bridge, and they look right and they look left. They look up and down them rivers. Sometimes they stop and gawk up and down them rivers. When you pull up on a bridge, the eye seeks the center. If there's nothing in the center, it goes to the edge. So Blackie, if he's working a set close to that bridge, I've got that canoe anchored and it's fully, even the motor's camouflaged, even the rock guard, I got it up out of the water, see? All right, I wear camouflage. The thing you gotta remember when you hear that thing pull up on the bridge, and he might be, you know, from here to that little shack down there from you, you don't face flash him, you don't look at him. You stay bent over and you don't move. He'll pull on. You finish working your set.
If you move, he's gonna watch you.
If you move, you've broke the contour. He's gonna see you. If you face flash him and look at him, he's gonna see that. But that's what I've learned to do and live with. Now, where was I supposed to answer? And I didn't.
How do you store
stuff? Yeah, I carried a minimum. All I was carrying is sometimes a small length of wire. I carried my tools, and I carried everything in a little plastic snap-on Rubbermaid box that fit under my seat. I could work on any trap. I could work on the motor. I had the motor tools in there. I could change a prop, extra pins, everything in case I sheared a pin. I carried all that in that little waterproof box under my seat. Okay, my T-tool that I push the earth anchors in with, you know, on the top end of the slide wire is in there. My paddle, of course, and I didn't carry a tiling spade after the first couple runs because I'd cut my steps in the bank or whatever to get in and out or wherever I needed it.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I didn't have to, but I carried a minimum. And yes, I did carry a pool cue that was weighted in the end and wrapped with camouflage tape for that one out of 150 coon that's sitting there alive when you get there. He hadn't went down the wire yet for some reason. I guess he couldn't follow directions. Thump him and, you know.
So what were you doing with your traps? You just weren't throwing them up in between you and the batteries. I can't imagine you doing that.
You mean when I set them?
When you're leaving the first day, when you're going to set. Because you didn't.
Well, I took them down before season.
Oh, so you had them. Okay, that's what I was getting at.
Yeah. They were attached to the slide wire. All I had to do is fish them up and break them open and set them. They were on the slide wire.
Because I've done a tremendous amount of canoeing. And you, like you're saying, you get in the middle of nowhere and you realize, you know, maybe this wasn't the best way to store this. It starts getting all out of whack and everything's getting clogged together. And you're trying to pull a trap out and it's hooking on your battery wires. And after a while, you learn, you know, because I can almost hear the Special Forces song back on the John Wayne movie. You know the one I'm talking about, John Wayne, when he did the Green Beret movie?
Yeah, but I can't remember what you're talking about.
The song, Several Wings Upon My Chest and all that stuff. I can hear that in my head when you're explaining all this camouflage going down the road.
Well, I'll tell you what I did now with the DPs. You'll like this. I set them at home. And I filled the milk crate with them. They'll stack in there real nice. Okay? And I took them out and put them on the slide wires set. All I had to do is fish them up out.
Mm-hmm.
You can make some real time when your trap's already on the slide wire. The slide wire's got the proper angle. Everything was done a couple days ahead of time in season. I do it farther ahead than that, but I mean, I don't like my traps out there too long at one time, you know what I mean? And when I had holes, I used to get nervous. I'd plug in holes with leaves, and every once in a while a coon would come up and dig one out, but the DPs were different. All you need was a little path or a little sign. Or a little sandbar, or a little whatever, and you're home free. And I had them painted mud brown. You know, and on a mud bar, you can put a big, if somebody's floating that river, you can put a big fire block there. You know, I call that them chunks of burned wood them campers had in the summer or something, and they can't see that damn thing if they're floating down the river. Mm-hmm. You got that between them and the trap.
Mm-hmm.
There's all kind of things you can do. If you're living with people.
Right.
If you haven't got people, that takes, you take that out of the equation, and I'll tell you what, it's a picnic. But that river is hostile. You look at that thing in the summer, you come up there and people are camping and fishing and playing their boom boxes and drinking beer, and you say, oh, I think I'll trap that in the winter. Doesn't that look nice? You get down there in December, and that is the most unforgiving, hostile, mean, cruel, brutal. It's just people that trap and they'll say, well, 30 isn't cold, Blackie. Yeah, you're crawling back up in your truck. You're getting warm. When she dumps you out on that river and says, I'll see you at 5 o'clock when I was running a full line, you get down there, you're, whatever decision you made to wear that day or what you're doing, I remember when I used to wear them Carhartt coats. It's when Gore-Tex first come out. Now, Gore-Tex does not breathe. You got to be alive to breathe. That is a complete misrepresentation that they're better because they're waterproof and they're light. But I remember telling somebody down at Coshocton at the Ohio State meet years and years ago, and there was a customer standing at my table. I don't even know who he was. He come off with the best one I've heard about that. I was telling him about my Carhartt coat and how it failed me on the river because it'd get wet, you know. And he said, oh, you had one of them triple 40 coats. And I said, triple 40? What are you talking about? Well, he says, it rains. And he says, it get wet and it weighs 40 pounds. And he said, you've got 40 gallon of water in it. And then he says, the wind goes through it 40 mile an hour. And I said, that's it. I said, that's the one. And those Carhartt coats might be okay for a guy on road construction. They ain't worth a nickel on the river.
Absolutely.
Now, they're not made for that. And I can dress far lighter, more comfortable, with Gore-Tex. I didn't think I could afford it at the time. At least my wife didn't. But since I can, and it's a lot better. A lot better. But I just thought I'd throw that in. The decision you make that day is what you're going to live with all day on that river. And by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I have seen this, you hoped and prayed you didn't have a coon in the next set, because I don't want to get out of the canoe. I'm so cold, I'm miserable, because you made the wrong decision.
Well, you know, river trapping to me, and it's never fails, and it's like, you know, when you know, like you, they say, Mother Nature. And the Indians call coyotes tricksters. Do you know, I can, when you're telling that stuff, I cannot remember starting out on a canoe line trip or a boat trip. The skies are always blue. The lake or the river or the big creeks are always flat. The current's going the right direction. The birds are singing. The squirrels are running through the trees. Everything is right. Your coffee stays hot all day. And you go and you start setting traps, and it just, and it like sucks you in, so you get more and more stuff out, and you probably should have. And about 3 days into that, the wind's blowing 40 miles an hour, you're white capping, you know, the in a canoe it's pushing you, and then in the middle of the day when it gets the coldest on this trip, it's going to rain for 45 minutes in 3 inches, and I don't care what kind of rain gear, you're getting wet.
And then the rain stops and the temperature drops 10 degrees and the white stuff starts coming down. And you're
well, not
miserable.
So much for me, but
yeah.
And it just stays wet for me. But that's always the way the river line starts.
Oh, it's a bear. It's a bear. It's nothing like people think it is. It's a bear. Yeah.
Let's, but before we finish up, one of the other things, we don't have to get into too much detail, but it's something to, for guys to really think about. Like I was telling you, I just got a Jeep. You know, I paid for a Jeep. Me and my wife didn't even take it out to dinner yet. I took it straight down to Tom's 4x4 in Chattanooga and dropped as much as I probably would on a good used Jeep, because I wanted new suspension. I changed the gearing. You know, I put the bumper and the winch on there. I got a specialized thing on the overdrive and stuff like that. And you don't see anything but the bumper and winch. But, you know, I could have bought probably a couple of good used Jeeps for what that cost. And I know when I go out in the middle of absolutely nowhere in Texas or somewhere like that, unless something drastically goes wrong, I'm coming back.
Absolutely. That's good money spent. I always said you could spend a couple grand underneath your pickup truck and it don't show, and it'll help you for the life of that truck. It depends on how long you're going to keep that vehicle, but don't go off the road with a stock vehicle. I mean, you're going to get stuck, you're going to get in trouble. I can't believe the guys that won't even spring for positive traction, you know what I mean? And another thing, when I was going out west, I never went out that I didn't have a sealant in my tires.
Like a green slime type thing.
Absolutely. And make sure when you get this, it'll withstand freezing temperatures. Some of that stuff, at least back in the day, wouldn't withstand freezing temperatures. You know, back in the early when they first brought it out. But everything out in Arizona, I said, had stickers on it. And that's true. And I've had thorns sticking out of them tires. They never leaked a pound, you know.
Well, you know, one thing to me, it's always, you mentioned this yesterday too. I don't think a trapper should own a vehicle he's going to trap out of without 10 ply tires.
Oh, absolutely.
Because you're going to be walking somewhere where you don't need to be.
Yeah. 4 plies only apply to one thing, cars. A truck should never, ever, ever have, if you got a small truck and you're never going to trap out of it and you're just going to, run it around to work and say, I would want 6 plies. Just for safety. Oh, 10's is, You know, I bought that Toyota 17-inch tires. I found out no major tire company makes a truck tire for it. So how did I get 10 plies on it and not mess it up? I went to the tire shop and they said, we can fix that easy. They went one size narrower, kept the height exactly the same, and I could buy any ply I wanted. Because they do it for the oil field guys, see?
Okay.
And they know what they're doing. And it didn't throw my computer off, my speedometer off, nothing. I got 10 ply tires.
Well, let's finish up, if you don't mind. Will you, the story about Bud Boda, when he went out there, because it's such a lesson for
someone. The guy's an Eastern trapper, and he don't have his Nissan set up. Nothing against Nissan, it's any of them. His Desert ate the front end out of his vehicle, and he had to get it fixed out there. And we all know on the road they charge you half again more than what they would at home. And you got the inconvenience, the downtime, you got your traps out, and I would never venture out there. The first time I ever went out, I had double shocks all the way around, heavy springs, and I'm set up. It's like I told you yesterday, it's not shine and show, it's grunt and go. Now, I know it's not, the guy wants sexy big tires, and he don't change his gear ratio. And those are kids. They got jacked up to where you could comb your hair in the rocker panels. You know what I mean? And you got, that ain't, a trapping truck, when they give you, that must have tickled me. When they give you a truck at the dealer, they give you an owner's manual. And I don't buy into this $100,000 mile maintenance. I don't buy it. At 95,000, that's supposed to get as good a mileage off them spark plugs as what it did at 15. I'm sorry. I don't buy that. My Toyota says replace them every 30. They don't have a long life plug, and I replace them every 30. I'm happy. They cost $3.85 a piece. I'm happy. Mm-hmm. Okay? They've got a severe schedule in there. So that means you shorten it up to about half of what normally you do. In other words, 50,000 mile this and that. Hey, I throw that book away when it comes to that. Not my manual. That's a figure of speech. When you're trapping, you'd better take care of that thing. I'm a big believer in K&N air filters, because the only way dirt can get in your motor is through the air breather. Okay, your air cleaner. And if you've ever been out west, I'll never forget the first time I ever seen this in Arizona. I was coming down off the side of a mountain, and here come a vehicle on the desert floor out there, how many mile, five, 6 mile away. He had a plume of dust behind him, a mile long at least. At least a mile hanging in the... You're going down that same road, and you're going to meet him. You're going to drive through it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got a factory air filter. I'm sorry, that's what wears motors and bearings and stuff out, is dirt. And a K&N will not allow that stuff through. Mm-hmm. In fact, is they even have a sealant grease you put on the edge of the filter to make sure it's sealed. And I'd say if you're driving in those conditions, invest in that little $2 tube or whatever it costs.
I use Vaseline, but same.
Yeah, and your K&N's guaranteed for life. It's cheaper. It's a 1,000,000 mile guarantee. You put that thing in your vehicle, both of mine's got it. Both of mine's got it right now, okay? I always run a K&N. And you can clean them. I clean mine. You buy a little kit and clean it. Just follow the instructions. That's just one of the things you can do. I believe in running synthetic oil because it's tougher. It's tougher than normal oil, okay? But it don't help to have extended drain intervals if you don't have a filter to match. You get down here to Walmart and buy one of them cheap filters they've got, and you can feel the difference between it and a 10,000. My filter in my truck right now says right on the filter, 12,000 mile. It's a 12,000 mile filter. I run my truck 10,000 and change the oil. I don't push it to the 12. I have. But you take, I let a service manager feel that once. They were changing my oil, and he said, my God, Blackie, He said, that thing's as heavy as one of ours when it's full of oil. I said, that's because it's got something in it. You know, it has some gauze, you know, but it, no, it's a special, you know, filament. But my oil filter is the only filter I've ever seen that it says right on the box, 12,000 mile filter. And I run all this kind of stuff. And then you ain't got surprises. I keep the oil, all the fluid levels changed underneath bumper to bumper on a regular basis. You know, no 100,000 mile.
Mm-hmm.
Cooking that stuff in the heat and towing and hauling. And, you know, if you treat that thing right, it'll treat you. Now, a lot of people don't change the oil in their transmission and the filter. I have never yet seen, I'm sure it's happened, but I've never seen a guy that changed the oil in his transmission and filter have a transmission go out on him. I've never seen him have problems with it. But you ask a guy who replaced his transmission, did you ever change the oil and filter in that? And he goes, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Go to a transmission shop and talk to those people. I've done that. You know, I drove to the shop, I go in, I talk to the guy that owns it, and I ask him, look, I just bought this vehicle. I want to keep it forever and a day. Here's what my plan is. And he'll listen to you and say, add something, or say you're right on the money, or, you know.
It's in the military, we had it's PMCS. We had to deal on every vehicle all the time, and it was scheduled out. And I've kind of got it in the still habit of that. You know, you're checking your oil before you do anything. And because I've been in some situations where, well, I'm not going to mention, a friend of mine walked about 17 miles in the last couple of years down in Texas because of maintenance, just because of pure maintenance. And then that really, you know, and I see those ranch hands down there with diesels, and they suck so hard, these new diesels they got with these, you know, one and two turbos and stuff. They don't change those oil filters because it's the ranch's truck and they really don't care. They care when it builds up so much pressure, it sucks the air filter into the intake. You know, and then now they ain't going anywhere and they're walking. Yeah, we better close up, but I really appreciate the time for you to do this. Like I said, this is, I tried to guilt you into it yesterday to get you to do this, because I know you get a little, you love talking, but you don't like talking on official stuff.
Yeah. You're right. One-on-one.